Welcome to Foxhill's Black Report, your daily source of Black news, Black views, and Black opinions. Today is Tuesday, April 19th. I'm Mimi Brown.
I'm Romeo.
I'm Kay Simone.
I'm Demi Lobo. And on today's report, Joe Biden, he told former President Barack Obama he plans to run for a second term. How White House insiders feel about the president defeating Trump for a second time. Meanwhile, the Supreme Court has rejected an appeal by an African-American death row inmate who claimed one of the jurors in his trial was racially biased, what a jury questionnaire revealed. Then, a group of Minnesota mothers are calling for change after police handcuffed a group of Black children. An attorney representing the case tells us what's being demanded.
Plus, NBA legend Shaquille O'Neal is putting up his personal funds to help a family mourning the loss of their three-year-old family member, but has an arrest been made? And Master P, Mr. Make 'em Say, wants to coach the Lakers. Is he the best man for the job?
We have all that and so much more on the way. This is our voice and our truth. So let's get it.
Well, according to reports, President Biden has told former President Barack Obama that he plans to run for a second term in the White House. Mr. Biden told reporters last month he'd be, quote, very fortunate to have a rematch of the 2020 election. Former President Donald Trump has already indicated that he plans to run again. And the White House insiders say Mr. Biden believes that he is the best candidate to run against Trump and defeat him. If there is a rematch, Biden would be 81 years old and Trump would be 77 years old on Election Day. Biden's approval ratings, though, among Black Americans, they've fallen significantly during his presidency. That's according to new data. Voting rights legislation and the Build Back Better plan, two issues that have a lot of support from the Black community that have hit major roadblocks in Congress. I think it's no coincidence that Democrats are eyeing a revival of the Build Back Better plan as we get closer to the midterm elections. We'll just see if they can get, you know, Senator Joe Manchin on board with it this time around. But the plan did have a lot of great benefits for the Black community. When we look at that Build Better plan, it had child care provisions for Black people. It also had infrastructure deals. It had, free community college. It had things for if you wanted to go back to school and you needed help for Pell Grants and things like that. So I really think that if they can do that, it would be a really good benefit for the Black community. So we'll see.
Absolutely. You know, the Build Back Better plan, infrastructure, the only one that Black Americans really feel like we didn't get pushed all the way through was the George Floyd Justice and Policing Act. That was the one bill that we felt like Biden kind of fell short on. Honestly, I feel like Joe Biden is absolutely the best man for the job. I'm pro Joe Biden. I like Joe Biden, what he's done so far. You guys know the only thing that is a sticking point for me is what? Student loan repayment. So if he could get student loan repayment and tackle that for me, I will be pro. I would walk around with a Joe Biden flag and put it in my front yard at this point.
Well, it has to be a master plan. That's how I feel, because midterms will always kind of give you a heat check of what it's going to look like moving forward, right? Now, Kamala Harris, she's going to be the VP once again. What if she decides she wants to run? Does it show that there's problems in paradise when it comes to what's happening within the White House? I feel like there's a lot of work that still needs to be done. Is he the best man for the job right now? Absolutely. I feel like he's handling things very well. But some people would say he's dropping the ball on a few things. So hopefully he can pick it up and score with those.
Yeah. Absolutely. And to kind of piggyback off of Demi and you, Romeo, I do think that, you know, Joe Biden is the best person for the job. But my biggest thing is the student loans. Can we get the student loans forgiveness, or can we have that plan across? Like, that's the biggest thing for me when it comes to that.
Because, yeah, I feel like universities, I feel like colleges are surviving right now without them being paid. So why not just go ahead and make it a clean slate?
Absolutely.
One thing for sure, he's going to have to do something if he wants the Black community to turn out the way that we did for him in the last election, right?
Yes.
Right now, we're waiting on some sort of substantial legislation, whether it's Build Back Better Plan, voting rights, George Floyd Policing Act. He's going to have to do something. Student loans. Give us something for our vote.
Absolutely.
That's where we are.
Because you needed us when you wanted to get in office, so it's time to repay that debt.
Exactly. Yes.
Absolutely.
Meanwhile, a member of Congress is calling to cancel student loan debt by appealing to how it may help people of all races and classes. Congresswoman Pramila Jayapal took to Twitter calling for student loan debt cancellation justice, along with racial, economic, and gender lines. Now, adding that the move, it would help close those racial wealth gaps that we're talking about here on our show. More than 43 million Americans owe a combined $1.6 trillion in student loan debt. Now, a new political morning consult poll from earlier this month, it showed that 64% of Americans support some form of loan forgiveness.
Congresswoman Ilhan Omar and conservative Republicans are in a war of words over a tweet that she wrote. The Minnesota representative tweeted over the weekend, commenting on a viral video showing Christian missionaries singing worship songs to other passengers on a plane. Omar responded, "I think my family and I should have a prayer session next time I'm on a plane. How do you think that will end?" Conservative pundits and GOP candidates pounced on the tweet. Trump-backed GOP House candidate Vernon Jones tweeted back, "Why do you hate Christians, Ilhan?" The black former Democrat then went on to tell Omar maybe she should go back to Somalia or Sudan if she hated America's freedoms of religion. Omar is an American citizen who immigrated to the U.S. in the early 1990s.
The Supreme Court says the Pentagon can punish an Air Force Reserve Lieutenant Colonel for refusing to get vaccinated on religious grounds. The High Court gave no reason in their unsigned order. The emergency application had dissents from the court's most conservative jurists. But neither Clarence Thomas, Samuel Alito, or Neil Gorsuch explained their thinking in the case. Lieutenant Colonel Jonathan Dunn says he wanted to be protected from punishment by the Pentagon. He was removed from command for refusing to be vaccinated against coronavirus. Dunn, who has received other vaccinations while in the service, says he decided not to get the shot after seeing President Biden speak about the vaccine.
And the Supreme Court is also rejecting an appeal by a black death row inmate who claims one of the jurors in his trial was racially biased. Conservatives on the high court gave no reason for rejecting Christopher Love's appeal. Love's lawyers say the juror should not have been seated after he believed non-white races were more violent. A jury questionnaire exposed the juror's belief. Love was convicted of murder for hire. The three liberal justices on the court, though, dissented and said Love should be allowed to pursue his claims with the justices.
And Senate Democrats, who face serious challenges in keeping control of their chamber, are doing well when it comes to fundraising. Now, Georgia Senator Raphael Warnock is bringing in the cash, and in the first quarter of this year, he took in roughly $13.6 million. That gives the senator a total of $26 million in the bank, and that's the most of any incumbent challenger competing for a Senate seat. Recent polls show Warnock trailing GOP candidate Herschel Walker by 2 percentage points in early polling. The second highest fundraiser for the quarter is Arizona Senator Mark Kelly. He took in $11.5 million last quarter for a total of $23 million in the bank.
And controversial Georgia Congresswoman Marjorie Taylor Greene is getting out-fundraised by a Democratic challenger. Marcus Flowers took in $2.4 million in the first quarter of the year. That's compared to the $1 million Greene raised for the same time period. But overall, Greene has taken in $8.4 million compared to the only 7%, $7 million Flowers has raised since the start of the campaign. Flowers is a U.S. Army veteran and has worked as a contractor for the State Department and the Department of Defense. Nevertheless, he will have a tough time. Georgia's 14th congressional district is all majority white, 75%. Donald Trump won the district in 2020 by a whopping 50 percentage points over Joe Biden.
The January 6th committee continues to interview former members of Trump's White House. The former president's future daughter-in-law, Kimberly Guilfoyle, testified in front of the panel Monday. Guilfoyle is a key witness to the events leading up to the insurrection. She helped organize the January 6th Stop the Steal rally that preceded the riots on the Capitol. Guilfoyle's appearance came weeks after she abruptly ended an interview with the panel in February.
The weed-smoking, Confederate flag-burning U.S. Senate candidate in Louisiana has raised over $1 million in his attempt to knock off a GOP incumbent. Gary Chambers raised $1.2 million. That's $724,000 more than the next candidate, trying to flip the ruby red state into the Democratic column. But it's way behind what GOP Senator John Kennedy has taken in. Now, Kennedy has ranked in roughly $23 million in contributions. Chambers' platform is based on social justice, health care, and voting rights, in addition to advocating for marijuana legalization.
Florida's education commissioner has rejected 41% of new math textbooks as new state textbooks standards go into effect. The banned books included materials that teach critical race theory, Common Core, and social emotional learning. Common Core was developed under the Obama administration. The highest number of rejected books were grades K through 5.
And a group of Charlotte police officers are under investigation for pointing a gun and handcuffing a teacher in a case of mistaken identity. Police body cams show them stopping Jasmine Horn in front of her home last June. Cops were looking for a stabbing suspect when they detained her. The police department investigation cleared the officers, though, of any wrongdoing, but Charlotte's Citizen Review Board plans to meet next month to review the incident. Investigators say the suspect had the same last name as Horn, but a different first name.
The mother of a Wisconsin black man who died in police custody is suing the local sheriff's police department. This is video footage of corrections officers pressing down on a 27-year-old Malcolm James's neck while he was locked up in a jail cell back in May. James is seated in a restraint chair. And autopsy, it shows that James died of asphyxia. Officers say James, who was on suicide watch, was smashing his head into the concrete wall of the cell. And when they tried to restrain him, the young man's mother is also adding into here, saying that she is suing the Racine Police Department and the officers who were involved for $20 million. Now, James, he was placed in police custody 4 days before as a precaution because he was suffering thoughts of suicide. Now, none of those officers have been charged in the case, but the nurse who was on duty has been fired. One thing that I want to bring to light here, honestly, I don't feel like we learned a lot about the prone position as much as we did until George Floyd tragically passed away.
Right.
Again, another instance here where we're on the neck, the back of the neck, on the neck, and I feel like police officers are using this tactic as a way, it's proven here that police officers are using this tactic to kill black people and say, oh, this is something that we learned in training. And the prone position, it needs to be abolished altogether. It doesn't need to be another way that police officers can kill us and use that as a reason, oh, it's a way that I need to restrain. I was fearful for my life.
Yeah, you know, after watching George Floyd and what happened that day, the whole world saw that, and you wonder how can they still say it's okay to take these actions when it comes to apprehending someone. It is a major problem, and I do understand the nurse has been charged, but what about these officers? If you have more than one officer there, do you really need to use that kind of force on the back of someone's neck, holding them face down where they can't breathe? That's a problem within itself. Like, you are trained to handle situations alone, but if you have help there, more than one officer is there, this particular situation should not be used at all.
Well, I think that we're dismissing the fact that he was called because of a suicidal attempt or
yes.
a suicidal thought. So to come in the situation and approach it in that manner, all in you know, just in general,
yeah.
is just blatantly disrespectful. And on top of that, it's just I don't know, it's just wrong. You know, there has to be other protocols put into place when it's situations like this. You know what I mean? Like, coming into it in that manner, why?
Yeah, you know, he the mother called 911, which for me is a little unfortunate because, you know, maybe there's a loved one, there's a neighbor, there's someone that you can call if you need a little help. They said that he was lighting his clothes on fire and he was having suicidal thoughts. So when you, you know, when she called police, I'm sure she called because she wasn't sure what to do. But in the same sense, you definitely need to, hopefully there's a family member, just anyone else that you can call. And he should have never been taken to the local jail.
Yeah.
He should have gone to a mental institution. He should have been evaluated. We should have seen, you know, someone caring for what's wrong with him mentally instead of locking him up for 4 days. And then the next thing you know, he's being tased, pepper sprayed, placed in a chokehold, and he's dead. And as you mentioned, the nurse is being indicted or
right.
charges against the nurse. It's the same thing that they did in that other case with a 56-year-old black man, and I believe that was in North Carolina.
Mm-hmm.
You know, why are we blaming the nurses instead of the officers that are actually committing the crimes here? You know,
right, yeah.
I mean, the nurse is being going before a judge or having to go to jail because she didn't urgently respond to his need. But he was dead for 3 minutes before they even noticed. So what do you want her to do? You know, and I think we need to really, really look at how we are responding to these things.
You know, it definitely just falls down to trying to find a cop out, someone else to put it on so that the police department doesn't look like they were the bad guy. And one thing you said, Mimi, that was really important is that, you know, when you have a mental health, a person who's going through a mental health situation, and not like how we go through like depressive moments or we're like, I'm talking about someone that really has a mental health urgent situation. Yeah. We really need to have some systems, case them on, like you're saying, that are set up in place, because it's scary when you're around someone. Honestly, I don't know if you have ever been around someone who's having an attack, maybe a manic attack. You're scared. Even if you're a family member, you're terrified. So the first thing you think of is, well, I call the police that they can help. But really, they're like we always talk about, there has to be a middleman that is trained in dealing with people that are having those manic episodes.
Whole different number to call, and that's how we're working toward it. Oh, we'll keep you posted on that story for sure. A federal jury has awarded a wrongfully convicted black man $6 million, but a North Carolina city is refusing to pay. Daryl Howard won his lawsuit against the city of Durham after being convicted in the 1991 murders of Doris Washington and her 13-year-old daughter. The jury found a retired detective, Daryl Dowdy, lied on Howard and violated his civil rights. Howard spent 21 years of his life locked up. His convictions were overturned and he received a pardon for the crimes. Howard had been sentenced to 80 years. Durham city officials have rejected their jury's judgment. They have decided they won't pay because they spent $4 million defending the detective that put him away. And if that wasn't enough, the city also wants Howard to pay the legal fees of two city workers dropped from the original lawsuit. Can you believe this? Here's a man that's fighting for his life. He went to every step possible to prove his innocence. He finally did that after spending 2 decades behind bars, losing those moments, those days, those hours of his life, only to be looked at and said, we're not going to award you what you should receive. Oh, yeah, and by the way, you need to go ahead and take care of this fee as well. That's a slap in the face.
Romeo, you're absolutely right. It's a slap in the face. He originally asked for $48 million. They awarded him $6 million. The detective that they spent the $4 million on to protect has been on the force for 36 years. So what they need to do at this point is go back and look at all the cases that this detective was a part of and see, because this isn't the first time that someone is pinning charges on someone. This isn't the first time that someone's lying on someone. So, you know, I think, you know, and I'm not in their brain, but when you spend so much money to defend someone who you probably know is guilty, is because you don't want to open Pandora's box. And Pandora's box needs to be opened all the way.
Absolutely. You know, well, so he talked about he missed his mom while he was in jail. His son died while he was in jail. And for some reason, I have a hard time believing that they didn't know that they weren't going to pay him his money. I honestly feel like they knew that they weren't going to give him the money. He went through every step that was asked of him. And it just really is, like we say, a slap in the face to not give him the money that he thought he was going to get.
Agreed. Absolutely. A group of Minnesota mothers are calling for change after police handcuffed a group of black children after reports of gunshots in the area. Video of last week's incident in Maplewood, Minnesota was streamed live on Facebook. It shows the black mothers confronting police officers who detained children between the ages of 10 and 16. Witnesses say Maplewood cops spoke to the children for 20 minutes without an adult present. When some of the mothers were told what happened, they rushed over to the scene and demanded their children be allowed to go home. An attorney representing the women say they want an apology from the department and are considering a lawsuit. I think they should do more than consider a lawsuit. And I definitely think had these been white children in a different area and there were gunshots or they heard gunshots, they would have been consoling them. Are you okay? Is there, can we get you water? Can we call your parents? Is there anything that we can do for you? Versus handcuffing them and detaining them. These are children, 10 to 16 years old.
Yeah, these are kids, and imagine the trauma, right? So you wonder why when kids grow older, how they may be getting pulled over for a license plate that's expended, but scared to pull over and continue going because they're scared for their life because what they encountered from a police officer when they was 10, which can lead up to them losing their life. I say all that to say this is why we have to have better police when it comes to the black community and people of color, because we can't bridge a gap and build that trust factor and all of that if we continue to have things like this happen when their parents are there screaming for them too.
It definitely goes back to the point that I made. It's about protocol. You have to have some type of protocol set in place, right, for these type of issues. It just seems like at this point, the policing aren't policing. mm-hmm. at this point. The police aren't policing. So what protocols do we have set in place for children? What protocols do we have set in place for mental health issues? What protocols? It stems down to the protocols. It's not even about the people anymore.
Yeah. And I'll just say this in closing. Just ask the police officer, would it be okay if that was your child in handcuffs when you walked up? How would you feel about that?